Buenos dias. My name is Gregory Long. I'm the president of the New York Botanical Garden, and it's a great pleasure for all of us to welcome this wonderful group here today to this symposium, the opening symposium for entitled Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera, Mexican Art in the 20th Century. And of course, it's in celebration of our exhibition, which is known as Frida Kahlo Art, Garden, and Life, which is open today to members of the garden. You'll see the members of the garden around during the day, and tomorrow to the public. We're going to be hearing this morning from Adriana Zavala, who's the moderator of this symposium and the organizer of it, followed by Mary Coffey, James Olds, and Juan Rafael Coronel Rivera, all very distinguished speakers on this subject. But just before we begin, I would like to recognize some very special guests who are here this morning who've helped us make this exhibition. We couldn't have made this exhibition without them. Here in the front row, some lenders of the works of art, which you'll see in the gallery later. Carlos Phillips Olmeda, the director of the Museo Dolores Olmeda in Mexico City. Armando Colina and Victor Acuna from the Galleria Arvil, also in Mexico City. I'm not sure they're here right now, but I also want to recognize other lenders to the exhibition. Silvia Navarrete Buzard, the director of the Museo de Arte Moderno in Mexico City, and Stephen Ennis, the director of the Harry Ransom Center at the University of Texas at Austin, and also Juan Rafael Coronel Rivera, who is here this morning, a lender to the exhibition, and John Shirley, who I think may be here. Then I want to recognize two other friends of the garden who helped hugely with the program, Janet Gelfman and Solomon Grimberg. If they're here, welcome to you too. We've been helped here at the garden greatly by the Mexican Consul General in New York, who's in the garden someplace, and she'll be here in a minute. Many of you know her, perhaps, Ambassador Sandra Fuentes Barrin. She'll, I think, be along shortly, but I just wanted to thank her very much and to let all of you know how much she and her office have done for us. And also Katerina Toscano, who's the executive director of the Mexican Cultural Institute in New York City. We couldn't have done this big project without the support of those officials from the Mexican government here. So now about Adriana Zavala. Adriana Zavala is the main person we couldn't have done this project without. Adriana is the guest curator for the exhibition and the moderator of the program this morning. Adriana is associate professor of modern and contemporary Latin American art history and director of Latino studies at Tufts University. She's published widely on Mexican art and curated exhibitions here in the US and also in Mexico. Her book, called Becoming Modern, Becoming Tradition, Women, Gender, and Representation in Mexican Art, has been awarded the Arve Prize by the Association of Latin American Art. She's a very distinguished scholar, and we are so honored that she's been here at the New York Botanical Garden doing this with us. We started this project in 2012, and I was just mentioning to some of our friends from Mexico City when the New York Botanical Garden went to Mexico City asking to borrow Frida paintings and saying we were going to do an art exhibition here. I think they thought we were a little crazy, but they all suspended disbelief and trusted us. And I think it's because we had Adriana Zavala with us, who she's not a botanist or a horticulturist. She's a card-carrying art historian. And that made all the difference. So now let's begin the symposium. Please welcome Adriana Zavala.
Good morning, everyone. It is such a pleasure to welcome you here to the symposium and to the New York Botanical Garden. I think you'll be very pleased when you get to finally see the exhibition. But before we let you do that, we're going to make you listen to us for a little while and teach you something, because my esteemed colleagues who are speaking today are all teachers, either officially or teachers, because they're so knowledgeable. So it is my distinct pleasure to introduce the symposium, but of course I'm not going to rename everyone that President Long just named, but I want to lend my thanks as well. We couldn't have done this project without our collaborators, and I am truly eternally grateful, so thank you so much. So I want to start just a little bit to say that this, as President Long said, this project took over 2 years, and I'm so grateful for the opportunity because it is a multidisciplinary project, and so that's the kind of work I really value as an art historian, to look at things from new vantage points and to ask new questions. And, you know, the very idea of doing a Frida Kahlo exhibition in a botanical garden was surprising to me when they approached me in December of 2012 during exam week. But as soon as I had been here, and as soon as I had even the briefest conversation, I thought, well, this is an extraordinary opportunity because it allows us to think in new ways about Frida Kahlo. I also want to mention that one of the really key pieces was going to the Casa Azul and the incredible support we had from the staff there opening the archive. So today we have the symposium, Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera, Mexican Art in the 20th Century. We have four speakers, and I have the honor of introducing them. I will say that I have no doubt that any one of our speakers, myself included, could talk for 2 hours and just scrape the surface, but we're limited to 20 minutes. So bear in mind that there may be some things that we just don't have time to explain in depth. So our first speaker this morning will be me. And the reason for that is that I'd like to try to create a framework and establish a context for the very rich information that then my colleagues will present. So I will introduce them and then I will proceed with my presentation. So first, following my presentation will be Juan Rafael Coronel Rivera, who was also an incredible collaborator on this project. He is a poet, photographer, novelist, essayist, critic, an art historian, and a renowned scholar of many things, among them Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo. He curated a wonderful project in 2005. The catalog is out for purchase. It's The Metamorphosis of the Image. And it's focused on Kahlo's intellectual roots, especially her grounding in science and positivism. And this book was a very important source for me, and I know for the team here at the Garden, as we began this project, because it really helped us, again, to expand our thinking about Kahlo in new ways and to really focus on Kahlo as a creative artist and as an intellectual, which I absolutely believe that she was had a very deep intellect. And he's also Diego Rivera's grandson. And as Gregory said, a lender to our exhibition and just generous in so many ways. And so his talk will be titled Diego Rivera and Gardening as a Vision of Aesthetics. And following Maestro Coronel will be Dr. Mary K. Coffey. She's the chair of the Art History Department at Dartmouth College and a specialist in the history of modern Mexican visual culture with an emphasis on Mexican muralism and the politics of exhibition practice. And she's published on a wide range of topics, including the exhibition of folk art. Her book, How Revolutionary Art Became Official Culture, Murals, Museums, and the Mexican State, is also available for purchase. It was published by Duke University Press and has won awards, and it was published in 2012. And her talk will be Nature, the Female Body, and National Allegory in the Art of Frida Kahlo and the Mexican Muralists. And then following Dr. Coffey will be Dr. James Oles, who is senior lecturer in art history at Wellesley College, and a group of Dr. Oles students are here, so a shout out to them. Thank you for coming during exam week. Dr. Oles has curated numerous exhibitions for institutions in Mexico City and the United States, and he's published very widely on foreign artists in Mexico, on the Mexican surrealist Pedro Friedberg, on political prints, photography in Mexico, Frida Kahlo, and his book, also available for purchase, is Art and Architecture in Mexico, 2013, Thames and Hudson, and this is the comprehensive English language survey of Mexican art from the conquest to the present. And it's a wonderful book. And his presentation is titled Frida Kahlo and Cultural Cross-Dressing in Mexico. So please join me in welcoming our speakers this morning. So before I proceed, I have to set my stopwatch so that I stop talking at the appropriate time. And while I'm doing that, multitasking technology, there's one last thanks that I have to give, and that is to my family. and particularly my husband and my son, Max, who have lived through my Frida Kahlo project for the last 2.5 years, and they're here today, so thank you to them. And I would name all the members of my family, but we'd be here for 2 hours. Okay. And my extended entourage. So my presentation, let me get my technology up here. Okay. And I have a pointer. So Frida Kahlo's home, the Casa Azul, is a creative refuge. And what I thought I would do this morning in the time that I have is share with you a little bit about our approach to the project and then talk a little bit about some of the themes that really the level of my understanding of Frida Kahlo in particular around certain themes has been so enriched by working on this project. So just by background, when I was approached in December of 2012 by the team at the Botanical Garden, what won me over immediately was the fact that they had developed a concept of exhibitions where they introduced the public to the plant sciences through the humanities. And this is exactly the kind of interdisciplinary work that I find so stimulating. And so I've listed the projects. I won't have time to say much about them. But our exhibition, Frida Kahlo Art Garden Life, is the latest iteration in a series that began with Darwin's Garden, An Evolutionary Adventure in 2008, Emily Dickinson's Garden, The Poetry of Flowers in 2010, Spanish Paradise, Gardens of the Alhambra, 2011, Monet's Garden in 2012, and then also more recently, Wild Medicine, Healing Plants Around the World, featuring an Italian Renaissance garden. And here's some views of the ways in which they evoked these projects in the beautiful Haupt Conservatory. And you'll have a chance to see the way that we've evoked Frida Kahlo's Casa Azul in the Haupt Conservatory. And just to give you a little bit of an amplification of that sense, when they installed the Monet show, they created this lovely Japanese bridge and this allée, and they borrowed one of Monet's palettes and two paintings. This is one from the Yale University Art Gallery, that were in the gallery. So what we began to do in 2013 was to think about the works that we could bring to the Botanical Garden. And Frida Kahlo is definitely having a moment, as the New York Times told us. But she's been having a moment for quite a while. And there are a limited number of Frida Kahlo works, roughly 250 original works, and many of them in private collections, museums in Mexico, private collections and museums here in the United States. And so we knew that this was going to be a challenge because the number of works is few, but also because she is so highly sought. There is an exhibition now up in Detroit, and so we did have some competition. So one task was to create a checklist, and there were, I can't tell you how many versions of the checklist, where we kept refining down to the works that we really felt could express what it is we were trying to communicate. But we were very interested as well in the Casa Azul and in understanding Frida Kahlo's relationship to her garden at what is now the Museo Frida Kahlo. So this is a beautiful Nicolas Mirai photograph showing Frida Kahlo leaning on a sculpture by the self-taught sculptor Mardonio Magaña, and these objects by Magaña, who was the porter at the Academy of San Carlos in Mexico City and discovered by Diego Rivera, stud. They're sort of features in the garden at the Casa Azul, and many of them are still there today. And over time, this is what the garden looks like now. And really, it is now principally a tropical garden. So this leads me to thank one more person, and this is Humberto Spindola, the artist. When we first went to Mexico in 2013, the archivist and the director, Hilda Trujillo, said, well, you really must meet Humberto Spindola, because he works here in the garden with us to help us create a beautiful space. And they didn't tell me that Humberto was an artist as well. So we met with Humberto, and he was incredibly generous with his time. And one of the things he told us is that the garden that is at the Casa Azul now is a tropical garden because there's much more water. It's been raining a lot more in Mexico City. And the trees that exist in the garden at the Casa Azul are much taller than they were during Frida and Diego Rivera's lifetime. And so he said, you know, what you're seeing here is really not what was here in the 1940s. And this was a very important piece of information. And he suggested what you really need to do is study photographs to understand. And he, in fact, has written a piece illustrated with photographs about the plants and the rocks in the garden at the Casa Azul. And then we learned that Humberto is also an artist. And so we've commissioned him to make a work of art for us. And I won't tell you what it is, but you'll have an opportunity to see it. After you see the art exhibition, you'll go down to the fourth floor and you'll see Humberto's original creation, which is truly stunning. So that was a very important piece of information. So we began to do that. We began to amass an incredible digital archive of photographs to help us understand the space at the Casa Azul. So what I'm showing you here is the original home. Guillermo Kahlo, Frida Kahlo's father, bought this home in 1904. It's kind of a typical vernacular home in its morphology and its footprint. And it was in a neighborhood that was being developed in Coyoacan to sort of bring people out of the city center and give them a more hospitable kind of green environment to live in. And you'll notice that the home has a neoclassical facade. And so this was a very stately home for a man who was an immigrant to Mexico and a photographer and his Mexican wife and their growing family. And this is the plan of the home. And you can see that it has a rectangular interior garden and the rooms each give on to the other, and there was this beautiful veranda. And these are photographs by Guillermo Kahlo. He documented the garden, and that's actually quite interesting. Sometimes he was photographing the family in a rather spontaneous way or casual way, and sometimes he was just taking photographs of the garden, which tells me that he cared about that space. So that was very interesting to think about why he would document that space. And so you can see that it was a sort of enclosed space, these beautiful plants and pots, there was an orange tree in the center, and it was a kind of kitchen garden. And the family would relax there, et cetera, and so forth. Of course, in 1930, Frida Kahlo takes title to the house. The years of the Mexican Revolution were challenging for the family. Guillermo Kahlo had been working as a photographer, receiving very important commissions from the government of Porfirio Diaz, and the government of Diaz was overthrown by the revolution. And so the family hit on hard times, had to sell some of the furnishings, and in 1930, Diego Rivera paid the mortgage on the house, and title went over to Frida Kahlo. And they didn't begin living there, though, because that was the period in time from 1930 to 34 that they were living in the United States, and they actually began to build a home for themselves, commissioned by their friend, the architect Juan O'Gorman, in the nearby Colonia of San Angel. But in 1936, Frida Kahlo creates this beautiful painting that's in the collection of the Museum of Modern Art here in New York, where she shows herself as a little girl standing in the courtyard of the garden. And I could talk for 2 hours about this painting, but I won't. But please notice that she has sort of interlaced her leg with the tree. And there are many reasons why she did that. But I'm really inspired and provoked by the fact that she begins to become one with nature in this space. And of course, this is a family tree. It's a family tree. Un árbol genealógico. And so she shows her Mexican grandparents here over the wonderfully rendered Mexican landscape, her German grandparents here over the ocean, and then her parents and herself, and then the creation of life here. So a lovely and provocative painting, again suggesting the importance of the garden for Frida Kahlo. So as we studied these photographs, we were amassing them and putting them in chronological order and thinking about how she was articulating her understanding of the space. So these are also photographs by the Hungarian-American photographer Nicholas Murai, and they had an intimate relationship in the 1930s, and he took a series of really important photographs, portraits, and also documentation of the space. And you can see that by about 1939, they had begun to transform the space. A lot happened at the Casa Azul over time. You can read my essay in the catalog, or read Juan Coronel's essay in the Metamorphosis of the Image. But in essence, they began to acquire adjacent properties. Of course, Leon Trotsky lived in the house for a period of 2 years. And to protect the home, Diego Rivera acquired an adjacent property. And then again, later in the 40s, he acquired an even larger property. So they were expanding the garden. And that again tells us that they cared about this space. So here you can see Frida Kahlo standing on the veranda, all of the Mardoño Magaña sculptures, the pre-Columbian antiquities that Diego Rivera was collecting. He eventually amassed a collection of some 50,000 pieces. Many of them are still arranged in the garden. Most of them are at the Museo Anahuacalli that he built as a mausoleum and as a museum to house his pre-Columbian collection. So they're really thinking in very interesting and creative ways about the space. Now, of course, we had hoped to find a period plant list, and we did not. There are some plant lists, but we had hoped to find that Frida Kahlo was noting in a notebook which plants were being planted in the garden. We never found that. It's not to say it doesn't exist, but we didn't find that. We didn't find her shovel or her gardening gloves either. I think of their socioeconomic status and the ways in which they were accustomed to live, it would have been the gardeners who were planting things, but that doesn't mean that they weren't thinking about it. And so I think the expansion of the garden and the articulation of the garden space as an outdoor living space is evidence of how much she cared about this. This beautiful photograph showing the pyramid that Diego Rivera built in the new property that they acquired and incorporated in the garden space. These are both photographs by the French photographer Gisa Lafroind, who was in Mexico in 1951. And here you can see some of Rivera's collection arranged on the different levels of the pyramid. And as part of our project, we wanted to give you a sense of what this garden is like. If you haven't yet had the pleasure to go to Coyoacán, I hope you will. But in the Haupt Conservatory, we worked with Scott Pask to design some set pieces, not to recreate, because that wouldn't be a sincere thing to do, but to evoke the feeling of the garden at the Casa Azul. And I hope we've achieved. I think we have. So we have built a version of the pyramid that you're seeing in this photograph, which was originally topped by a palapa straw roof. So one of the things that the archivists at the Casa Azul showed us was this incredible drawing that you can also see out in the Ross Gallery. We've reproduced it on the wall. And they didn't know who the drawing was for, but the drawing is by Frida Kahlo. It's of her garden. It's a very, very funny drawing. It says, my house is not so comfortable, or my house is not so pretty, but it's comfortable, something like that up here. She's hung the laundry on the line. There's a blue shirt. She's labeled the colors. There's a blue shirt and a little eye with a dotted line to the blue shirt. One of the things we were trying to figure out was when did they paint the house blue? And there doesn't seem to be documentation of that. It could have been in 1936, around the time that she did that painting I showed you. She's drawn all the little menagerie of animals that she had. She's labeled them. She's labeled some of the plants. She's labeled Frida and Diego's bedroom. So I believe that this drawing postdates their reconciliation and remarriage in 1940. And there's also one bedroom labeled Your Room. And so I believe that this drawing was done for Emmylou Packard, who was an American woman who had lived in Mexico as a young girl, had also been sick as a child, and had developed a very close friendship with Frida Kahlo by the time that they were adults. And Emmylou Packard was an assistant to Diego Rivera in San Francisco when he painted the Pan American Unity mural. So she came to live at the Casa Azul in 1940-41, and this is a beautiful, beautiful photograph attributed to Diego Rivera of Emmylou and Frida. And I think the intimacy of their friendship is expressed in the gesture, but also in the fact that they're wearing their hair the same. And I love blonde Emmylou Packard with the yarn in her hair. And then this beautiful photograph by Nicholas Murai showing Frida with her little deer. And then again, the Murai photograph, just to really amplify the fact that while we didn't find the smoking gun, the gardening trowel, the garden gloves, the plant list, there's no question that they cared about this space, that both of them cared about this space. So I also want to talk just a little bit about another concept, which is the idea of Frida Kahlo as a collector. And if you go to the Casa Azul, of course, it's been curated. It's a museum. So we have to recognize that things are not necessarily arranged there as they were during Frida's lifetime. But again, if we look at photographs, there's certainly some correspondence. So this is a Bernard Silberstein photograph where you can see her standing next to shelves just full of things. She would tell her friends, when you travel, bring me something. Bring me a little toy. Bring me a little memento. And she would collect these things. And here we see her painting at her easel. Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera collected retablos. These are these little miniature ex voto paintings, often painted by self-taught artists. And they were arranged in the hall in the stairwell. I believe that arrangement was actually the first curator of the Frida Kahlo Museum when it opened in 1958, the poet Carlos Pellicer. But it's a very wonderful way of displaying these paintings. This is a Gisa Lafroind photograph, I think from the 60s. And one of the objects that I love is a cabinet, and I'll show you in a moment. This is a detail. But in one of the bedrooms, there is this armoire that has a glass front. And it's full of all kinds of wonderful little toys. And it gives you the sense of how much Frida Kahlo loved little things and the sense of humor that she had. So there's a little skeleton, some pre-Columbian antiquities. You can't quite see it, but there's a little shoe, a little Victorian doll shoe, more dolls. She loved to collect things. And so this gives us a sense of her being a collector of paintings. She also had works by modern artists, a collector of sculptures and folk art and little toys and a collector of plants. She also has this, what we call a cromo, a French print that shows butterflies. She also had a frame full of actual butterflies pinned to a piece of cloth above her bed. And one of the things that the archivist showed us, we asked to see Frida Kahlo's books related to plants, and we saw many interesting books about the medicinal properties of plants, how to identify certain kinds of trees, and these books are in various languages. So, of course, underscoring the fact that Frida Kahlo was very well educated and very, very intelligent. But she had a copy of Walt Whitman's Leaves of Grass, and inside of that copy, she tucked little dry flowers. And as I was looking at this page, thinking about the relationship of the text to the object she placed within the leaves of the book, I noticed this passage here. Let others finish specimens. I never finish specimens. I start them by exhaustless laws as nature does, fresh and modern continuously. And that for me has become the way that I think about Frida Kahlo's relationship to her garden. It was not systematic, but it was spontaneous and deeply felt. So I wanted to highlight that for you. Some other wonderful photographs, again by Gisa Lafroind, contemporary photographs that we took when we traveled to the garden to be able to bring back memories of the plants and ask our experts, Todd Forrest and Fran Coelho, to identify them for us. I'm not a plant scientist, as Gregory said, I'm an art historian. But we found this photograph, and I'm just so fascinated by it, and I asked Juan Coronel if he could help me identify the women. We can't figure out who they are. But of course, if you look, what's happening is that they're sitting in the garden at the Casa Azul, and this woman is holding a pot with a plant, and the little boy is holding a teeny tiny little pot with a little cactus. So either they're giving her plants, or she's giving them plants. That seems like a pretty intentional thing to do. So I wanted to underscore that. And then to briefly talk about Frida Kahlo, the artist, I am mindful of my time, but you'll see these works in the gallery, and I just want to help orient you a little bit. So the focus of our exhibition is not biographical. There is so much scholarship on Frida Kahlo, so much of it biographical, so much of it interprets her paintings as sort of plotting a course through her life. It's not to say that that's incorrect. It's not my particular focus. So I'm very interested in her relationship to plants, and you'll have a chance to see this lovely little watercolor called Small Life, where she's arranged, she's in sort of colored pencils, she's drawn a little daddy long legs, as I call it, a little pill bug, as I call it, because I'm not a scientist, a wood vole, a little flower, perhaps a feather, and it's a very unusual vantage point, but you get the sense that she's paying attention to nature. And then over here in this extraordinary drawing called The Dream, this is, despite being a drawing, it's so delicately done. It's one of my favorite works in the show. And it was actually a work, and I'll explain in just a moment, that really cemented for me Kahlo's relationship. Think of her as the fecund earth, laying in a bed, and both in Spanish and in English, a bed is a bed, is a gardening bed. Una cama. To cultivate plants, a bed to plant flowers, and her hair is growing roots. It's engulfing the Detroit landscape. One of the paintings you'll get to see is this extraordinary painting by Luther Burbank. I said early on, if I can only get one painting, I'll make a show around it. It's got to be the Luther Burbank painting. Burbank was a California horticulturist who died a couple of years before Rivera and Kahlo were in Detroit. You can read about this in the book, but very interesting man with very interesting ideas. Anybody heard of the Shasta Daisy? He created the Shasta Daisy, the Burbank potato. He was an experimenter. And so I believe that Frida Kahlo, because of the way that she expressed him, appreciated that Burbank was expressing that hybridity was a good thing. The context for this is the United States of the Depression, the deportation of Mexican Americans, even if they're citizens, in a context of economic crisis, and a rising tide of fascistic discourse that says hybridity, particularly between human races, is degenerative. Frida Kahlo, in her body, was a hybrid person. Mexico is a hybrid nation with a Spanish root, an indigenous root, an African root, an Asian root, a Lebanese root. We have many roots in Mexico. And I believe that Kahlo, in these years, was finding ways conceptually as an artist to challenge that very negative discourse. Back to this beautiful drawing, The Dream. As I was looking at it, I was thinking about these works, and it was Mia Davanza here in the gallery that pointed out that Kahlo has rendered the first stages of the germination of a seed, a cotyledon, and I thought, this is why I'm working with science people, because I would not have known what that was. So thank you, Mia. This is the value of teamwork, right? Of course, my reference is that Kahlo, here pregnant in Detroit, is probably thinking about the Tierra Fecunda that Diego Rivera had painted in the Agricultural College of Chapingo, where he showed his wife, his previous wife, Lupe Marin, pregnant as the fertile earth. And he also depicted the Italian photographer Tina Modotti as the virgin earth. And it seems to me that Kahlo is combining these images, expressing that she is now Diego Rivera's fertile earth. You'll see this wonderful painting called Flor de Vida, Flower of Life. And our interpretation, it's been interpreted as having to do with Kahlo's sense of failed fertility. It could be. But my interpretation is that it's Kahlo's expression of the human-plant hybrid, of dualism, of the interdependence of opposing forces, imbalance, and of fertility. And we believe it could be a floripondio. This is a floripondio flower, a red angel's trumpet, and a Mexican poinsettia. Look at the similarity of the leaves. And this work is truly her expression of her creative agency, the interdependence of male and female. Notice this explosive event occurring in the middle of the painting. Looks very much like female and male reproductive organs. And these are some of the works that you'll see where this concept of the interdependence of the human realm with the natural world, with the vegetal world, she emerges as a supernatural being from a flowery, leafy backdrop. This incredible painting, Sun and Life, where she transforms the spathe and the spadix of an erasia into a womb with a fetus inside. And then this conjoined double self portrait. This beautiful painting where she shows herself as a sunflower. Two nudes in a forest, the sense of humans enveloped by nature. And then Frida Kahlo's extraordinary sense of humor. Look at this melon. It's like an open mouth with teeth. It's going to munch at you. This little flag stabbing the mame. Mame is a euphemistic term for female sexuality. So you'll get to enjoy all of this. But again, to underscore, really focusing not on Frida Kahlo's biography or the tragedy of her life, but Frida Feliz, the happy Frida, the exuberant Frida, the dynamic Frida Kahlo. Thank you very much. So I will now welcome Juan Rafael Coronel Rivera to the podium.
Hello, my name is Juan Coronel. And I'm going to talk about Diego Rivera and how he contributes to make the concept of the Casa Azul gardening. Well, first of all, we have here a photo that is Diego in his new house. This is a very early photo. It's 1934. Diego was at his study in San Angel, and he already has developed this whole aesthetic surrounding the house with all these cactuses as a fence, that it's actually something that he took out from his hometown, Guanajuato. I want to stop here to remark the extraordinary work that Adriana Zavala has made for the botanical garden. It's amazing how sometimes you look some corners and you really can feel you are in the Casa Azul. This is incredible because it's not just a pastiche, it's really something impressive, and I can really congratulate her. First of all, we have to know when all this aesthetic come from. Here, you have a house, a roof house in Mexico City. And here you have Guanajuato. The main thing is that gardening in Mexico has not only been proposed for the dirt, for the real dirt, but also for the roofs. The life, it's very important in the roofs in Mexico. Still, by example, in some cities in Guanajuato, people live in their roofs because the climate led them to live there. The things here is that we have always think of the Spanish influence in gardening, in Mexican gardening, in the 1900s. But what we haven't thought is that most of those gardening does not come from Spain. It comes from the caliphates. And here you can really see by example this tapestry here. This is a Turkish kilim. So here you can see the whole influence and the influence of the Arabics. And if you've been in Turkish and if you've seen the life in the roofs of Turkey, you can really find out the relationship between the living in Mexico in the roofs and the living in the Asian countries. Here you have Guanajuato. Diego born in Guanajuato in 1886. And if you been in San Miguel de Allende, most of you have been sometimes in San Miguel de Allende, you can see that life and the roofs in San Miguel de Allende are very important. The plants that they do, the landscapes they do for the roofs are very important. And the tradition come for this much about the caliphates and all this Arabic tradition that Diego inherited. This is very important because his roof and the family and her mother was really very preoccupied and interested in do all this gardening in the roof. So Diego, that's why he got a lot to the roof in his hometown, Guanajuato, and start to finding out all these Cubist statements of Guanajuato that he made when he was a Cubist artist. The second most important influence of Diego was when he came to school in Mexico. Diego's father was persecuted in Guanajuato because he was a Mason, and Guanajuato was a very Catholic city. So sometime around 1890, he has to emigrate to Mexico City, and Diego began to go to school. When he was 10 years old, he was able to go to the academy, to the lessons, night lessons. In those night lessons, he attended a professor, his name was Professor Rios, that was his main professor for drawing. And Diego became a fantastic drawer. He started drawing when he was a kid, but at the academy, he was really very interested in drawing. This document you have there is his best scholarship. The first scholarship he received from Justo Sierra. Justo Sierra was the director of education of Mexico in those times. He runs all the education of the country. So was a very important person, was a very important person in Diego's Rivera life. What is very interesting about this first scholarship that he receives in a paper is that he drew a landscape. So we can find there that his idea of landscaping and landscape was part of the art. What we have to state here is that Frida Kahlo's garden and Diego Rivera gardens, because Diego Rivera, as I'm going to tell you, he developed more than one garden, was part of his art. Gardening is an art. And especially in artists, is a branch of their aesthetic. It's like their libraries and like their collections. All these together make a whole concept of the world and of the view of the world and the view of art. So in the case of Diego and Frida, landscaping is part of their art. So what we are seeing here in this show is another extension of Frida and Diego's art. Well, here are the most popular park in Mexico. It's like the Central Park in New York, that it's called Chapultepec. And Chapultepec is really important because, by example, those trees you have there up, those were planted by the Tloatanis in the Aztec era. So those trees has 2,000-3,000 years, and they're still there. And that was a really pre-Columbian aesthetic for a garden. If you want to imagine how a garden of a prince of the pre-Columbian times were. This has much to do like it. So it's a very different concept of what we have. The thing is, by the example in the codices, especially in the Sagún codice, that it's our main resource for the Aztec research, we don't have really, and we have the explanations, but we don't have a drawing because all this codex has a lot of illustrations by the Tlacuilos, but we don't have really the sense of what was going on those gardens. But here is something that we can really find as a real pre-Columbian kind of a garden for what it was. And here is a version of Maximilian. As you know, we were a kingdom for a few years. And Maximilian built this castle, and also he regardened the whole section. So here you can have the two sections, the mostly pre-Columbian. Of course, it's not, I mean, a pre-Columbian, but it looks a little like. And here you can have the idea of how Diego found the gardening in those times when he was a student at school, because it was very similar. This is 905, he was in the academy. Exactly is the same year that he got the scholarship. Also, as Frida, Diego got a very interesting education, and his mainly education was in the positive science line. That it's very important because as Diego was very interested in scientific phenomena, he was always studying it. He collected animals. Most of the animals that now we attribute to Frida were bought by Diego, the monkeys, all this kind of animals. Diego was very close to their animals, especially to their dogs. And he was inspired especially in crumbs done by scientifics of German. This is his mural, Water, Origin of Life, made in 1951. And here you have a book that was on Diego's library. If you see this frog, and if you see this frog, you can notice that he take the frog out from this book. Diego was, as Frida, they took a lot of information from scientific books, and they recreated sometimes equal, just in different contexts. And this is very important because all this has to do with the botanic and the idea of the botanical recreation and the botanical aesthetics. Here also, you can see in the same encyclopedia, because this is an 8 volumes encyclopedia, the recreation of an area of some zoological group. And here you can see this lobster, and here you can see the same lobster. So he continued watching all these scientific things, and when he are doing his gardening and part of his gardening, he's also thinking in all these scientific statements. Diego moved to Paris in 1906. His first works were very European. He made some modern statements based on Surat. And the development that he was using in the first stage of the works that he made in Europe from 1906 to 1910 were only related to Europe landscapes. But in 1910, he made a trip to Mexico, and was the first time that he really got a sense of what was the Mexican landscape, because when he was very little and he first made his first trip to Europe, he didn't got the idea of this. He got the idea out of Mexico when he returned. So here, in 1918, this is a photo of him when he come to Mexico. And in 1918, he started recreating some landscapes in Europe that are very similar to the landscapes of Mexico. he noticed that there was a terrible difference between some of the landscapes that are the tradition of the Europe tradition and the landscapes of the Mexican tradition. And in this area of France and Catalonia, he found that there were some very similar landscapes as the Mexican landscapes, and he started to recreate this as a nationalistic point of view. In 1914, he put the first Mexican cloth into a painting. It's a painting that is here at the MoMA, at the Museum of Modern Art, that it's a portrait of Jack Lipschitz. In that portrait, he put for the first time in the history of art, a piece of folk art. And he's doing the same thing with this landscape. He's putting a nationalistic statement in landscaping in modern art in Europe. So we have to consider that painting of Jack Lipschitz and this painting as a similar statement. There he's pointing his nationalistic view. When he arrived to Mexico in 1921, he started to make his first mural. His first mural was for the Preparatoria Nacional. He started doing this mural late 1921, and he finishes in 1923. And the landscape that you can see in that mural, it's not a Mexican landscape. It has a lot of influence by European art. So José Vasconcelos, that was a minister of education in those times, says, Diego, you are committing a mistake. You are doing European art here. And you, the idea of developing all this new concept of art is to recreate our essence, what we are. So Vasconcelos made a trip with Diego and some other intellectuals to Oaxaca. But right now you can take a plane to Oaxaca. In those days, make a trip to Oaxaca takes 4 or 5 days, and you have to arrive where they gone to Juchitán by a mule. So you can imagine Diego, Lupe Marin, his wife, Vasconcelos, Miguel Covarrubias, and Roberto Montenegro arriving to Oaxaca in a mule. Well, they did. And they were astonishing because in those days, the Juchitán River was one of the most important rivers in the whole republic. Now, there has no water in that river. But when Diego arrives, it was a fantastic river, and the women were naked, washing themselves and washing their clothes in the river, and the exuberance of the gardenings and everything. Well, Diego was absolutely impacted by this. What they didn't tell them is that when you get closer to this woman that were washing, the woman takes stones and throw it to you. That was not idyllic. They were really aggressives. So here is the first real statement on Diego on a landscape, on a Mexican landscape, and on really a garden. This is the stairway to the Ministry of Education. And it was done in 28. This here is the first by example. This stone here is Xochipilli, that it's the goddess for the garden in Mexico, is the goddess for the flowers. And he put it as the center of the whole scene. And all this woman that it's adorating Xochipilli is Dolores Olmedo, the patron of Diego and mayor collector of Diego Rivera paintings. And as you can see, if you remember the painting that I'd show you that he made in Europe, all this landscaping here is very similar to that painting that he made in 1918, because he has really, he's thinking in all this new way of seeing another landscapes that are not part of Occident, of the Occidental tradition, because what we have to understand is that most of the things that are included in the Mexican modern art are not part of the Occidental tradition. Mexican modern art, it's an eccentric art, and that is very important because it's that what we apport to the world. Then Diego finished his mural in the Secretaría de Educación Pública and the Education Palace in 1929, and he moves to the United States. And here is when he really took conscious of the importance of landscaping. The idea of Diego, when he came out from Mexico, was to become an American citizen, because he says that the only country in the world that was really prepared to make the next step to become a real socialist country was the United States, because the complete, no, it's incredible, but his theory, it's true, because it was the only country that has developed all the real structure of factoring and fabrics and everything to really make the next steps for make a better society. And when he came to the United States, he was very impressed about all the importance that vitamins, gardening, and production of fruits was going on in California especially. And here you have a mural that he painted called Still Life and Flowering. And if you can see, it came out from all the advertisements that was happening in California in the same time. Diego was very aware of modern, and here he was using some pop art statements that obviously was developed in the 50s, 60s, to make his mural, especially all the propaganda ideas of gardening. And in the same mural, as you can see here, this is an advertisement of the gardens in the Valley of California. And if you can see here, the tractor and the whole thing, this is our olive plants, almond plants flowering. And you can see he used the same aesthetic to develop his mural out from these advertisements. So his moment when he really understands the importance of gardening as we know gardening and as a statement as this garden, this botanical garden is built, he got it in the United States. When Diego arrived to California, as Adriana has already established, Luther Burbank, that was the leading experimental gardening in California, has already passed. But the most important, the best studied of student of I forgot. The best student of Luther Burbank was Leonard Noel, and he was a landscaper, an architectural, very important architectural landscaper in California. And he was the one who developed all the gardens for Luther Burbank. So it was through Leonard Noel that Diego knew Luther Burbank and knew what's gardening, landscape gardening as an architect, as a part of architecture, was so important. And he is the portrait of Leonard Noel by Diego. So we have by truth that they were together a lot, and that he was the one who explained to Diego the importance of landscaping. And here we have the most important work of Leonard Noel in an island California, developed in 1944 for Helen Newman. And here we have Diego's first portrait of Luther Burbank. This is in the Allegory of California. That was the first mural that Diego developed in California. And as you can see, he is getting united with the earth and with the flowering, because one of the most important things of him is that he make himself bury in a tree and with no plates, with no nothing. He just buried that in the tree, and Diego is doing here like a kind of vanitas because Luther Burbank was already dead. And this is the house of Luther Burbank with no nails landscaping. Well, oh my God. Okay, well, here is Frida Kahlo's house. What I want to point here, if you see here, there's no any pre-Columbian art. Then when Diego arrives, all the pre-Columbian art start appearing in the garden, and Diego set all these pre-Columbian pieces by pointing water, fire to the area in the gardening. This is the study that is one of Diego's first developments in gardening. And here is something that I want to stop, because we thought that Diego was only involved in doing two gardens, the Casa Azul garden and an Awakali garden, but that's not true. Diego developed at least 7 gardens. This is his garden in Chiconcuac, Morelos. He developed the pool, the gardening, and there was also some murals related to gardening and water. And also something that I want to point is that Diego was the one who made the development of El Pedregal. Most of the persons think that there was an architect, very important architect in Mexico, that was the developer of El Pedregal. But what happened is that in 1940, Diego wrote a letter explaining the importance of El Pedregal, and the university, El Anahuacalli, and the Pedregal as a whole idea of a development was an idea by Diego Rivera. And we have 10 pages written by him by hand explaining this. Here we have one of the first photos of Diego in the lands of an Anahuacalli, with planning the first structures that they're going to be there. And these are the letters. When he traveled, he sent letters to her daughter, Ruth Rivera, explaining every detail how he wanted to make all the construction. Here's Ruth Rivera, that she actually was an architect, and she finished the Anahuacalli and some of Diego's drawings around the Anahuacalli. And this is when I want to say that it's the most important thing. This is a drawing by Ruth Rivera. This is the plain of the whole land in the Anahuacalli. This is the real plain of the first part of Anahuacalli. This is unpublished. And this is the state of the Anahuacalli in 1964. The roof was done by Ruth Rivera and O'Gorman. But the main thing of this plano, of this plain, is that it explains exactly the idea, because Diego, when he stayed in Anahuacalli, he stated it as the first ecological park. And he explained it like that in the 40s, as the first ecological park. And the idea was not only to build the Anahuacalli, the museum, but a whole city of the arts. And here in this plain, you can see each of the buildings and the distribution of the buildings in the whole land of the Anahuacalli, that actually now it's only the rocks and this park. But the idea of Diego of the Anahuacalli was really to develop a whole city for architecture, for dance, for music, and for every art. And every single part of the Anahuacalli got a building that Carlos has to build it now. But, well, thank you very much. That was a general idea.
So Hello. Well, I want to thank everyone here at the Botanical Gardens who's made this a really easy and wonderful experience. I want to thank my good friend and colleague, Adriana Zavala, for her efforts to put this beautiful show together. I'm very excited to see it. I want to thank my co-presenters for what they have said and what they will say. And it's nice because what I have to say, I think, will complement what has already been said. I'm going to sort of pull the lens back a little, sort of away from the Casa Azul and the particularities of Kahlo and Rivera's interest in gardening to a sort of broader period discourse and to think about how Kahlo and the ways in which she's in a creative dialogue, intellectual dialogue with her peers in the muralist movement is using landscape imagery, botany, horticulture, and plants in her paintings. So let's see here. And I'm gonna give a more formal presentation. So indulge me. I won't be quite as dialogic. So I want to begin here with this. Actually, it's a Dutch engraving from around 1600. And in this engraving, Jan van Stratenis attempts to image Amerigo Vespucci's arrival in the Americas, and he presents this encounter through the gendered visual language of an incipient romance. Here, Vespucci, standing clothed and bearing the accoutrements of European science and technology, here he is, approaches a recumbent America, figured as a nearly nude indigenous woman in the idiom for indigeneity of the 1600s. Upon his approach, she startles. She begins to rise from her hammock. She reaches out to him, implying a form of consent for what will transpire. In her book, Imperial Leather, Anne McClintock characterizes this print as a compensatory image of empire, one in which the inequalities and violence of encounter are smoothed over and made more palatable via the natural hierarchy of the sexes and patriarchal power. It is compensatory not because it is ideological, it is ideological, but that's not why it's compensatory, but rather because it seeks to disavow the boundary loss that accompanies encounters with the other. It's an attempt to manage this sort of profound discomfort that comes from encountering a world you don't know, that doesn't conform to the world you do know. What interests me about this image is that it figures encounter through the gendered language of heterosexual coupling. And in so doing, it set a precedent that has cast a very long shadow within artistic practice, particularly in colonial and decolonizing contexts, such as Mexico. And today, I want to explore not only this tendency as it appears in the work of the Mexican muralists and Frida Kahlo, but also as it relates to the parallel tradition of using the female body and its attributes, fertility, beauty, vulnerability, strength, etc., to symbolize the land, and vice versa, to use the attributes associated with the natural world to promote idealized representations of women. I will ask, what are the implications of analogizing the female body with the landscape? How does the presumed subordination of the female body naturalize colonial and neocolonial configurations of power? And in turn, how have artists both upheld and contested these tendencies in Mexico? With respect to this final question, I hope to convince you that one of the most significant aspects of Kahlo's engagement with the natural world, that is her interest in botany, plant genetics, and plant symbolism, is precisely the way she uses this information to critically engage an often patriarchal and at times neocolonial imagery in the nationalist painting of her peers. So I want to turn to two canonical images, images I love, I've written about many times, from the Mexican mural Renaissance, both of which were executed in 1926. The work on the left is José Clemente Orozco's Cortés and Malinche. The work on the right is Diego Rivera's The Liberated Earth with Natural Forces Controlled by Man. In the Orozco, the gendered and cultural coupling that we saw in the Dutch print has shifted from a scene of encounter between the human Vespucci and allegorical America to a scene of conquest between the historical figures of Hernán Cortés and his indigenous consort and common law wife, Doña Marina, otherwise known as Malinche. Despite its historical reference, it is nonetheless an allegory of the conquest and subsequent mixing of Spanish and indigenous culture, what would become known as mestizaje. In this sense, Cortez's masculine attributes, strength and control and mastery, are contrasted with Malinche's feminine qualities, passivity, softness, mystery, to visualize essential cultural differences between the old and new world. Spanish culture here is dominant, cold, controlling. Indigenous culture is the fertile source of national reproduction. It is, after all, embodied by the female figure. But it is impassive, difficult to access, both because women are the dark continent, to quote Freud, but also because Cortez's act of subjugation has cut us off from any direct access to this vital resource. In contrast with Orozco's allegory of mestizaje, Rivera's conveys great confidence in the post-revolutionary state's capacity to harness the earth's natural forces for the good of national development. In his fresco, Mexico is rendered as a comely mestiza, in actuality, as we've heard, Rivera's then-pregnant wife, Lupe Marin. She reclines nude within the landscape, while around her water, fire, and the wind are also personified as male and female types whose force is being controlled by a new man for the good of the nation. In this scenario, and here I'm referring to this figure down here who represents this sort of new post-revolutionary figure who is engaging with these natural forces here, and you'll note that Marin's body is in the literally in the shape of the Mexican national gestalt, that she looks like Mexico, with Mexico City situated roughly here around her belly button, her very pregnant belly. So in this scenario, the heterosexual romance on view is one between Mexico, allegorized through the fertile body of Marin, and this new man. The confidence in the image belies the political struggles transpiring in this period over land reapportionment and modernization. And in this respect, it too is compensatory, using the body of Marin to reassure its audience that modernization is a good thing and part of the natural order. Throughout her career, Kahlo engages with this tendency within Mexican art. Perhaps the most famous and fully realized example of her work in this vein is The Two Fridas, a large canvas painted in 1939, following her very painful divorce from Rivera. Here, Kahlo uses the circumstances of her life, her childhood accident, her divorce from Rivera, her family's multicultural genealogy, to allegorize mestizaje not as a heterosexual romance between a man and a woman, but rather as a painful scene of self-love and laceration. Here, two Fridas, one donning the highly praised costume of the Tijuana, the other the foreign garb of a Porfirian-era woman, sit holding hands. The Tijuana Frida is relaxed. She holds a miniature, a painting of Diego Rivera as a child, and this memento is attached to a vein that winds around her arm and connects with an exposed but intact heart. From there, a second vein travels to the other Frida, where it bifurcates, and one end attaches to a heart that has been cut open to reveal its ventricles, while the other travels down her arm, culminating in surgical pincers that fail to stem the blow that now pools between her legs on her dress. These two Fridas represent Kahlo's two halves, her mother's Mexican heritage and her father's European genealogy. The two halves correspond as well to the nationalized ideal of the Tijuana and the denigrated chingada, or woman who is too open to foreign influence. And likewise, they represent the Frida that, quote, Diego loves and the one that he does not. While it is all too easy to cast this as a transcription of Kahlo's painful divorce, I argue that we read it as a critical engagement with the cultural politics of mestizaje, one in which Kahlo literalizes the sense of double consciousness that comes with embodying two cultures, a task that was relegated symbolically to women. Rather than rendering her mestizo identity within the idealized and closed form of an allegorical nude, Kahlo represents it through her damaged body and her failed attempts to approximate that ideal. That is, her very hybridity means she can never be sort of truly authentic within the terms of the discourse. Moreover, she shifts the scene of post-colonial racial and cultural mixing from the heteronormative register of romance to the homosocial register of feminine self-love. Kahlo's self-portrait recasts the national allegory as one that impinges upon women in unequal ways, demanding that they perform their allegiance to the nation while circumscribing the conditions of that performance and relegating their role to that of procreation. Any other identity is conceived of as not only treacherous but also wanton, a repetition of the negative behavior of the chingada. Two other works from Kahlo's oeuvre will help us to better appreciate the complex ways that Kahlo has woven her biography into the discourse on the nation, at once staking a claim upon mestizaje, while also querying the terms in which it had been cast. In my grandparents, my parents and I, Kahlo uses the form of the Mendelian heredity chart to visualize her family genealogy. She holds a satin ribbon that loops around her parents to connect with portraits of her maternal and paternal grandparents situated over an indigenous landscape and the sea, respectively. Kahlo stands within the courtyard of her childhood home, nude and rooted within its gardens, about which we've heard so much. And as a child, she represents the possibilities of youth. But in choosing to represent herself at this age, she attempts to circumnavigate the sexualization of the female nude as a procreative resource. And instead, she displaces that sexual activity onto the landscape, where we see sperm fertilizing an egg alongside a multi-petaled prickly pear plant with ripe red flowers in bloom. As Adriana Zavala suggests in her catalog essay in Here Today, Kahlo's bisected rendering of the flower captures it in the act of releasing pollen, which floats over the image of egg fertilization, thereby situating Kahlo's birth within the Mexican landscape and associating it with a highly nationalized plant. It's a kind of displacement of sexuality onto the landscape and a claim on that national citizenry. In this way, Kahlo stakes a claim upon the discourse of hybridity that was idealized in post-revolutionary Mexico without disavowing her paternal lineage and without recourse to a sexualized allegory of female procreation. In Two Nudes in a Forest, she once again makes use of a same-sex scenario to allegorize mestizaje. Here, two women, each visually raced, embrace within a wild, natural landscape. As the authors of the catalog note, Kahlo subverts the gender and racial hierarchy one sees in works like Orozco's Cortez and Malinche. Here, a light-skinned woman rests her head on the lap of a darker-skinned woman. The same-sex configuration and the suggestion of dependence in this scenario confuse any easy conclusions about who is the victim and who is the exploiter. Likewise, the thicket of entwined branches behind the two women imply an intertangled relationship that is at once organic, but also possibly damaging. Might some of these branches die as a consequence of having been constricted this way, or do these plants represent the kind of incredible creativity and flexibility of this kind of intertanglement? Next, I want to turn from a discussion of gender genealogy and mestizaje to a focus on the tendency in Western art to analogize the female body with plants in the natural world. And this is a tendency we see across the history of Western art, not only in Mexico. I start with two examples from Mexican art, David Alfaro Siqueiros' Peasant Mother, where the artist equates the stalwart maternal figure with the sturdy cacti that dot the rural landscape. The other, Diego Rivera's image of Tijuana's, admits the harvesting of sugarcane in the isthmus, where he draws visual analogies between the Tijuana's and the cane itself. And this is particularly evident in the way in which he mirrors the striation of the cane and the pleats in their traditional dress. I want to compare works like these with one of Kahlo's many self-portraits, in which she situates herself within a shallow but lush space filled with recognizable vegetation. In this instance, Self-Portrait with Monkeys from 1943, Kahlo places herself amongst the leaves and exotic bloom of the bird of paradise plant. As with the flora in all of her self-portraits, Kahlo forges visual analogies between her own features and those of the plant. The bird of paradise species is native to South Africa, as are so many exotic plants. However, it thrives in tropical environments and is closely associated with Mexico and other locations deemed to be exotic in the international imaginary. Kahlo surely understood the connotations of this flower and chose it precisely for its purchase on this imaginary as an icon of paradise, and it has the same name in Spanish and English. Kahlo's engagement with the flower's paradisiacal connotations may be seen as an intervention in Rivera's flower female symbology. In works like Flower Day, Rivera employs the calla lily, a flower associated with death and rebirth, as well as great beauty and sexual allure, to both associate Mexico's folk traditions with something beautiful, but also to link contemporary flower vendors with Mexico's deep traditions, whether they be the open-air markets that flourished before the conquest or the use of flowers in popular folk rituals like the Day of the Dead celebrations. In either case, the flowers associate indigenous culture with a life cycle, thereby linking post-revolutionary indigenismo with the concept of cultural renaissance. At the same time, Rivera also used this plant to evoke a much more commercialized and modern beauty in his paintings, such as his portrait of Natasha Gelman. In this work, Rivera uses the suggestive sexuality of the bloom to craft Gelman as a Hollywood pinup. Her thin legs peek out from the folds of her scant satin gown, much like the yellow spadix that protrudes from the lily's white petals. So the calla lily and bird of paradise, while both tropical plants, have different qualities and connotations. However, I want to submit that there is a connection between Kahlo's self-portrait and Rivera's tendency to use this particular plant as a sign of both commodified sexuality and authentic indigeneity. In the great city of Tenochtitlan, viewed from the market at Tlatelolco, one of the frescoes dedicated to pre-conquest life at the National Palace that Rivera began in 1941, we see three women wearing a white huipil with red decorative border that Kahlo dons in her self-portrait. I'm talking about these women here and here. Two of the women engage in regular trade activities, while the third and most prominent holds a flower and lifts her skirt to reveal red shoes and elaborate tattooing. And she is clearly an icon of sexual exchange, a prostitute. Additionally, she seems to be crowned with a halo of calla lilies mounded in a manner similar to that depicted in Flower Day. Rivera based this figure on the visual depictions and textual descriptions of evil women in Book 10 of the Florentine Codex, as Juan was mentioning, the most often turned to source for information on Aztec life before the conquest. Among many claims about the physical appearance of the harlot, the text exclaims, quote, "She appears like a flower, goes about with her head high, her cheeks are colored, and she arranges her hair like thorns." In Self-Portrait with Monkeys, Kahlo represents herself as this indigenous guise. Her hairstyle, darkened cheeks, and haughty appearance subtly evoke the attributes associated with prostitution in the Codex. And throughout her life, Kahlo reveled in using her sexuality to offend the sensibilities of decent people. In her self-portraits, she often draws attention to her sex organs, and she was notorious for swearing, drinking, and bisexual escapades. Consequently, she must have felt a kinship with the prostitutes described in the Codex as rude, drunk, and shameless. Further, her willingness to court public shame in her own life had a political edge. Not only was it consistent with the bohemian stance of vanguard artists, but it was also linked to her critique of the gender politics of a colonizing gaze. After her long stay in the US, her embrace by the surrealist, and a sojourn in Paris, Kahlo was keenly aware of her exotic positioning within international circles where her Tijuana drag was celebrated as authentically Mexican. Within Mexico, her performance a la indigena was viewed as a contrivance, a capitulation to the nationalist politics of post-revolutionary mestizaje, and a compensatory gesture to obscure her quote-unquote foreign heritage. Kahlo's self-portrait bears testimony to her complex negotiation of national prescriptions for the performance of gendered and racialized norms, as well as international assumptions about the erotic Latina woman, Latin woman. In Self-Portrait with Monkeys, she invokes this problematic through her use of the bird of paradise flower. However, rather than court this exoticizing gaze with an emblem like the calla lily, Kahlo subverts it, for unlike the lily, the bird of paradise is hard, waxy, and sharp. It does not have the voluptuous curves or sense of willing openness that we see in Rivera's portrait of Gelman. Via the features of the flower and the presence of the monkeys, Kahlo offers a scene associated with licentious sexuality but devoid of sexual allure. In conflating the two modalities of Rivera's use of the lily, Kahlo's self-portrait seems to acknowledge the allure of indigeneity for contemporary nationalist intellectuals while also troubling the gender politics of that desire by substituting herself for a more idealized and generic India Bonita. In my final minutes, I'll explore yet one more motif in Mexican art along these lines, and in this instance, I look at how artists represent the rocky, unyielding landscape of the Pedregal. We've already heard about this project in the last presentation. From the 1930s to the 1950s, we see a number of paintings and prints related to this region in the southern part of Mexico City. This artistic interest coincides with two really important projects, the development of the Jardines de Pedregal in the 50s, on the one hand, but begun earlier, and on the other, the building of the museum house to house Rivera's collection of Mesoamerican art known as the Museo Anhuacalli. Both projects were located in the Pedregal and both sought to integrate modernist development. I'm not going to talk in detail about these images because you've already seen them, but these are just representations of the way in which modern architects were in situating modernism, signified by this kind of brutalist mid-century style, into this a landscape which was deemed a kind of authentic and deep landscape because of the ancient provenance of this lava flow. Here are just two-dimensional works that also take on this theme, Orozco's Rocks or Pedregal from the 1930s, in which he represents these indigenous women as kind of immovable in the same way that the rocks are kind of an impenetrable landscape, and Siqueiros's late 40s work painting, in which he sort of lionizes this as a sublime landscape. And in both of these works, we see a close association between the peasant female body and this particular landscape. So I want to compare Kahlo's numerous references to this highly symbolic landscape in her paintings by focusing on just two examples, the Broken Column from 44 and Roots from a year earlier. Both of these paintings were likely inspired by Rivera's project and the couple's interest in the Pedregal during that period, and they both clearly refer to Kahlo's deteriorating health, in particular a series of treatments that she endured to secure her spine. In these works, Kahlo inserts her biography and concerns into this landscape motif in ways that significantly complicate the relationship other artists were drawing between the rocks and indigenized and feminized peasantry in pre-conquest Mexico. In the Broken Column, Kahlo situates herself within the Pedregal, and as with Self-Portraits of Monkeys, she draws analogies between this cratered landscape and her own body. Her torso has been rent vertically to expose a shattered classical column where her spine should be, thereby allegorizing her health crisis and turning her ravaged body into a national body, one that has incurred the same traumas as Mexico. The column here represents the classical tradition imported by the conquest, and by extension, Kahlo makes her wounded body a symbol of exploited territory rather than assert the Pedregal as an emblem of cultural power that can be harnessed by modernity. She emphasizes the violence of modernity to the national body. Roots does the opposite. In Roots, we see her presenting her body as this illusionistic window and this plant where her spine should be sort of spilling out into the landscape and shooting roots down into this rocky rocky landscape. And so I'll just end by noting that I find this painting, Roots, to be a very hopeful one in which she wears her Tijuana costume almost as a dream, sort of as a shield, investing in that indigeneity and asserting that her body can be a source of insight for the national discourses. And so I'll end by just noting that clearly by the end of her life, plants have become an important part of this powerful lexicon in her paintings. In Roots represents a highly particularized engagement with the persistent and universalizing artistic conventions that link women, the natural world, and colonized peoples, whether it be Stratonis's print in The Age of Encounter or works by Rivera, Orozco, and Siqueiros in post-revolutionary Mexico. And it is precisely this particularity that reveals to us today what generic treatments of this theme really can't, and that is that even though women function as boundary figures for national imaginaries, these representations can be highly constraining for actual women who bear the brunt of performing the nation and safeguarding its traditions. Thank you.
Okay, some of you need to go to the bathroom. Probably, feel free. None of us have a lot of time, and I have to close, and probably Adriana is going to be even more ruthless with me, but I do want to thank not only her for inviting me, but Joanna Gork and Gail Schmidt from the Botanical Garden, who helped us all with our travel arrangements and everything, and my students who are sitting right here, a few over here and a couple over there, who are all in a Frida Kahlo seminar with me this semester at Wellesley College. And I'm getting ready to read their final papers. They're, whoops, what did I do? I'm sorry, tech people. Did it unplug? We might need a tech person. Yeah. I don't know what I just hit. Whoops. As I was trying to make that joke, something just unplugged. And it's coming back. Oh, there it is. Okay. All right. So by my students who, over the years at Wellesley have given me so many incredible ideas that filter their way into my work, often uncredited. I'm actually not going to talk about plants. In the 30 years since Hayden Herrera's groundbreaking biography of Frida Kahlo, which came out in 1983, a seemingly endless bibliography of books and exhibition catalogs and articles has been generated on her work, sometimes focusing on her personal life and more rarely placing her work within a broader art historical context or cultural context. What I think is it's not really necessarily always so important to talk about direct sources in her work, although we can do that, but to consider some of the broader cultural frameworks that shaped her and shaped her the decisions that she made. And I think some of those things have definitely come up in this lecture, whether it's Rivera's murals or, as Juan was talking about, Rivera's interest in the garden, et cetera. If we think about the Casa Azul as a big theatrical stage set in which both Rivera and Kahlo participated, a stage set where they could receive visitors, prominent international visitors, a stage set where Kahlo could appear photographed, and a stage set where she took, and they took, a basically banal, average, boring 19th century house, and through color, through paint, through plants, through folk art, transformed it into this really unique project, which still today in Coyoacan stands out like a sore thumb. So we can see the way Kahlo dressed as a part of a theatrical costume that worked within that theatrical stage set, and she too wanted to stand out like a sore thumb in both the Casa Azul, but of course also in all sorts of public places that she went to. So I'm going to talk about Kahlo's costumes today. All right. So the first thing, I noticed there are some women here, I don't think there'll be any men, that are wearing Mexican indigenous costume of some sort, right? And we've got some over here and saw some huipils. Of course, we've got our sort of Frida, and I saw some others. Well, one of the things is, I'm not going to talk, I don't know about people in the room, but one of the things that we have to remember is that when Kahlo is wearing these costumes, like this Tijuana costume from the Isthmus of Tehuantepec, from Juchitán in the south part of the state of Oaxaca in southern Mexico, we have to remember that Kahlo is an urban, sophisticated woman who is dressing up as a Tijuana. She's not a Tijuana. And what she's really doing is something that in the scholarly literature is now referred to, because it's a broad phenomenon that goes, we can find all across the world, as cross-cultural cross-dressing. Now, she also did gendered cross-dressing, wearing men's clothing, but I'm going to talk about cultural or cross-cultural cross-dressing. And she wasn't the first, and what I really want to explore today is the context for what she was doing, and also perhaps a little bit of the legacy of this, which is what some of the women are participating here in this room. Now, I can only really signal some of these things. I'm going to try to go quickly because I have quite a few examples, but this is part of a broader research project that I'm working on for an exhibition that's going to take place in Australia and Mexico City in 2017, 2018, about Mexican traditional costume. Now, Kahlo's costume has been most frequently, been often discussed in relationship to Rivera, meaning he told her what to wear, he wanted her to wear some of these more traditional costumes. Sometimes it's discussed in relationship to her accident, in other words, she had to wear these long dresses to hide her crippled leg. So, and sometimes the costumes that she wears are tied to her particular political sympathies with the working class, although these very elite, expensive, and complicated garments are difficult to consider as working class garb. Fundamentally, though, a costume like this might be read as indigenous. We might sometimes talk about them as Indian costumes. But Kahlo certainly recognized them as products of cultural blending of both European and indigenous sources, and often with Asian or other influences. But today, I'm going to avoid going into a discussion of the anthropology behind these costumes, which she wore her own way. Not the local way, often mixing and matching things in a sort of collage of different objects and textiles and dresses. What interests me is where she got the idea to do this cross-cultural cross-dressing, because she wasn't the first to do it. And if we're even to ascribe it to Rivera or to think of Kahlo, who begins to wear these Mexican costumes, indigenous or mestiza costumes, only after, really, she meets Diego Rivera, we have to wonder where he got the idea. And then we have to ask, why was she empowered to do this, and why she selected some costumes and not others? So those are many questions, and I won't be able to answer them all today. But I want to start by saying that this is a very broad field, and we have to look at Kahlo wearing these indigenous costumes in the relation with a long history of women, particularly, wearing exotic dress, from John Singleton Copley's depictions of American women dressed a la Turkiri, Turkish style, at least what they thought was Turkish, or maybe more famous, the Japonism of the 19th century Impressionists. And of course, we can all run up, as I will be tomorrow, going to the Met, to see the show on the impact of China on Western fashion. So this is a very broad field. And I want to remind you all that one of the things I think we're trying to do as scholars increasingly is avoid looking at Kahlo as having some sort of a unique biography that created a unique body of work, which is true for every artist, but maybe a richer or an equally rich area way of exploring her work is to see how she fits in the big picture. So that's sort of the past. Now, I'm going to stick to a Mexican genealogy of images here, and I think maybe, I might not be sure, probably Cortez was the first cross-cultural cross-dresser, because he already began to wear Mexican huaraches and things very early. He was criticized for it, for kind of cross-wearing Indian clothing. But at least in the arts, let's start with Juan Cordero, who painted this image of Columbus before Ferdinand and Isabella, while he was on a scholarship in Rome in 1850. Big academic painting, big history painting from the 19th century. But what's interesting about the picture, what I want to talk about, is simply that there are these indigenous figures over here in the corner, and Columbus is gesturing to them, and they are sort of these gifts that he's offering to the king and queen, and they have brought with them birds and stuff, you know. Well, one of the interesting things in the scholarship on this painting is that some writers believe that the Indian kneeling in the foreground is actually a self-portrait of Cordero himself. Here he is in a portrait. And the idea is that Cordero had to present this painting to the Academy back in Mexico City. So he's kind of seeing himself as it's a gift that he's giving, and he's honoring the head of the Academy, who's as great as the King of Spain. And so there's all these coded messages. But if it is, this would be the first self-portrait in the history of Mexican art of somebody dressing like an Indian who was not themselves an Indian. And the fact that he's doing it in this European court might remind us of how Kahlo dressed up when she went to Paris to stand out too. So this is just sort of, I'm gonna skim all over the place. Now, Cordero, I'm sure, never dressed as an Indian, but a woman of his social position in Mexico in the 19th century probably would never have either. It might have been very hard for a woman to dress in any kind of an indigenous costume at that time, a woman from the upper class, an urban woman. And we know this is true because there's a great anecdote recorded by a woman named Frances English, who was the Scottish-born wife of the Spanish ambassador in Mexico. And she wrote a book that some of you might have read. And if you want some summer reading, I highly recommend it. It's called Life in Mexico. It was first published in 1843. It was a bestseller, still in print. And in this book, which is about her experience in Mexico, she tells the following story. For a benefit ball that was organized by the most distinguished ladies of Mexico, Fanny, as she was known, proposed to wear the dress of the China Poblana that you see on the left, a 20th century version on the left, but something flashy like that, which is worn here by an actual China Poblana in a painting done in the city of Puebla in 1850. Bright colors, rebozo, high sleeves, a lot of skin showing, and often with a lot of flashy jewelry as well, sometimes with sequins. Now, Fanny said that she was inspired by a Mexican woman who wore a dress like this to a ball in London. Well, what was possible in London was not so easily done in Mexico City. She was really a bold lady. She ate mosquito eggs and drank pulque and was, you know, tried everything. But when she wanted to wear this dress, although the wealthy women helped her get a dress and helped her fit her into the dress, she got up one morning to find that the Minister of War, the Mexican Minister of War, the Mexican Minister of the Interior were all sitting in her parlor, and they had come to quote, discard her of the idea of making my appearance in a Poblana dress. They assured us that Poblanas, women from Puebla of this type on the right, were generally loose women. They wore no stockings, and that the wife of the Spanish minister should by no means assume, even for one evening, such a costume. Fanny even brought out the dresses to show them, and I suppose maybe the stockings that she was going to wear, but it was in vain. And this gives you a sense, I think, that at a particular moment in Mexican history, for a wealthy, elite, urban European woman to cross cultural dress was impossible. Men, I think, could. We have a couple examples of actually American male artists in Mexico in the 19th century dressing as Mexican cowboys. Henry Farney, who's really quite unknown, but this painting on the right is more interesting. It's thought to be a self-portrait of Frederick Remington riding horseback dressed as a Mexican cowboy. So maybe men had an easier time of it. But I've yet to find any example in art of a woman in Mexico in the 19th century, an elite urban woman dressed up across a culture, dressing with this type of stuff. The first example that we will find in the history of Mexican art, certainly one of the most famous examples, is Saturnino Herrán's portrait of his wife, Rosario Arellano, here on the right, in a famous portrait of 1914. Herrán was a direct contemporary of Diego Rivera. They really, as young men, were fellow students. They were the same generation. They were really the two principal artists of their time. Herrán never went to Europe and died in 1918, so we don't know a lot. He's not so familiar, but if he had lived, certainly would have probably become as famous as Rivera. So this probably must have been a very radical portrait of the time. We have other portraits of his wife wearing quite modern clothing. But the revolution was underway by 1914. The old order was being upturned. Old rules were being broken. But the interesting thing here is that Herrán's wife wears the Tijuana costume mistakenly. She's partly wearing it, and it's partly just draped over her, that he's used it to ornament her, but she's not really wearing it in the correct way. And I know that because even though I said I wasn't going to talk about anthropology, I was in front of this painting once with a very old American anthropologist who knew about the costume, and she explained to me why it was improperly worn. But anyway, by 1914, cross-cultural dressing was becoming perhaps possible because of the revolution. In the 1920s, even after her accident, Kahlo was thinking of being modern. Her short hair and her adoption, she's cutting me, so I'm just, see Adriana? All right, I'll go as fast as I can. In the 1920s, even after her accident, Kahlo was thinking of being modern. Her short hair and her adoption, at least in one famous family photograph of men's clothing, was a performance of being modern, an affiliation with the flappers of her time, as Adriana has discussed in her book. In her very first self-portrait, Kahlo was performing, though not as an indigenous woman, far from it. In the so-called self-portrait in a red velvet dress, what she's actually wearing is a bathrobe, inspired, I think, by Edward Weston's famous seductive images of Tina Modotti, his lover, wearing a kimono, which was part of a long history in the tradition of art of women wearing these Asian or exotic dresses, right? So Kahlo is already trying to be a little exotic, or certainly sexy, there in that early painting. But what I want to explore is, how does she get from that, of trying to be modern, to that? And she had a lot of models, and that's what's really interesting. Before Kahlo ever thought to ever wear anything indigenous, the American journalist Alma Reed had dressed in the huipil of the Yucateca from Yucatan Peninsula, and probably in this photograph, I think it's 1924, as a journalist, she went to the Yucatan. She interviewed the socialist governor of the Yucatan, Felipe Carrillo Puerto, became his lover. He eventually gets assassinated. But this is probably a very early example of here now an American woman going Mexican to express sympathy, political sympathy, with this new socialist government. And as an outsider, she's going to be even more likely to do this. Well, so here we have the lover of the Mexican politician. This is the American wife of a Mexican artist, Miguel Covarrubias. Although her stage name was Rosa Rolando, she was born Rosamond Cohen, so she was a co... Not... No, I know we're in New York. C-O-W-A-N. I'm... Yeah. But anyway, 1926... She is photographed with Tijuana garb long before Kahlo ever dressed as a Tijuana. And again, what we have is the American wife of a Mexican artist performing this. So you start to see maybe the wife, the idea of the wife or lover has to do this. And then it's all over the place. This is the wife of Carlos Merida. She's probably wearing a Guatemalan textile, which is where he was from. This is the... common like lover, I guess, of David Alfaro Siqueiros, the Uruguayan Blanca Luz Broom poet, wearing pre-Columbian necklace and having her hair braided up there with yarn in this indigenous style. Again, wives of these artists performing as indigenous, even though they're not. So we see that Kahlo is modeling herself, I think, on these prototypes. These gringas and extranjeras were cross-dressing, cross-cultural dressing, not only before Kahlo, but also before Maria Izquierdo, a painter who was Kahlo's contemporary and who's also famous for wearing these indigenous costumes. Now, one thing I want to end with is asking why Kahlo actually never dressed as a China Poblana, even though women did dress as a China Poblana, like Rosa Rolando there in a photograph of 1926, or very interestingly, this portrait by the German artist done in Berlin, Christian Schad, of this woman who I assume must have been part of the Mexican diplomatic community, precedent for some of you down there, here in this portrait of 1930 done in Berlin of a woman, Mexican woman probably, wearing a China Poblana costume. But Kahlo never dressed as that. And I think although the Tijuana costume had already been partly appropriated by mass culture, I think the China Poblana costume, as it evolved in the post-revolutionary period, with too many sequins and with that super hyper-nationalist eagle on the cactus stuck right there in the front of it, was too touristy, too associated with vaudeville performances, and maybe even with official culture, and not closely enough associated with difference, with cultural difference, with being other, with being indigenous, or being a mestiza, because the China Poblana costume is really the costume more of white women. So anyway, by the 1940s, 50s, I mean, there are cross-cultural dressing Tijuanas all over the place. It had become a sort of cliche. Tamayo's wife, Kahlo, Carlos's mother, Dolores Olmedo, in this famous portrait of 1955. So, and you know, you can go to Oaxaca today on an afternoon and see a lot of American women wearing huipiles walking around the plaza. But in fact, by the 40s and 50s, this was such a cliche, the American wearing a huipil, Indian costume, that one critic attacked Juan O'Gorman's library at the National University, which has a stone mosaic mural over the steel frame, you know, modern steel frame building, as a, quote, gringa dressed as a China poblana. So, I mean, it was such a cliche that you could, an architecture critic, maybe it was Frank Lloyd Wright said it, I'm not sure. And the culmination of all of this, which is really interesting too, is that this use of folk costumes becomes also becomes a very political thing. And the most famous example of this is during the Echeverria administration in the 1970s, where Maria Esther Suno dressed in indigenous costume. But what's interesting, although I don't have it in this photograph, Echeverria too began to wear guayaberas as an example, as you know, to try to again express some sort of solidarity. And you know, could make some parallels here, but I don't have a lot of time. Finally, that these costumes can be worn by any of us, in fact, including men, is evident in these two paintings that I want to end with by the contemporary artist, the late Julio Galan, a leading figure in a sort of neo-figurative painting style of the 1980s known as neo-Mexicanism. Galan was based in Monterey and New York, and he was part of an international circuit that was disassociated with and disaffected with official culture and official nationalist costumes. And in these two paintings, in which the face of the subject is gone and there's simply a hole cut out of the canvas, in the work on the right, somebody is posing behind the canvas and looking through it, a real person. He reminds us that these costumes are just carnival shams. Mexican women, gringa tourists in Oaxaca, singers, artists, and others still cross-cultural dress, but they were inspired less by Kahlo than by a long and complicated tradition, a cultural field that at the same time we can see how it informs her work even today. Thank you.
I know everyone's hungry, but we will take about 10 minutes of questions. If you do need to go, of course, feel free. If you'd like to stay and hear a little Q&A, of course, we're happy to answer some questions. All right, so those of you who are eager to ask a question or two.
Are we on? Yeah. This can be kind of informal. I mean, people can leave. But we don't have so much time. So if you do have questions, might just want to get right in there. And
anybody have a question? Or are we all eager to go to lunch? Yes, here in the middle.
So you want to know about the history of women wearing blue jeans after I just told you about the history of Joanna costumes and Yucatec costumes? I would say that already in the 1920s, I know that for, you know, for Americans, there probably it's more of an American thing that they're picking up on. I wonder if she got it kind of in California.
Denim is also the workers.
For women, no. I mean, like,
but I think it's pretty unusual. I mean, I think for Kahlo to be wearing that, it's part of her own form of cross-cultural cross-dressing. Juan might have something to say about it. No. So
one thing is there was an American muralist in Mexico that I've worked on named Marion Greenwood. She writes about. Yeah. Wearing jeans to paint murals, that it wasn't appropriate to get up on the scaffold and, you know, somebody could look up your skirt. So, but that she was criticized for for wearing jeans.
I think, again, you know, I once heard Juan in a documentary on Frida Kahlo say that Frida's manner of dressing was an aggression, and I thank you for that. And I think that whether she's wearing it, they want a costume, or whether she's wearing blue jeans, she's making a statement. I mean, I prefer blue jeans to a Tijuana costume, personally, because you can run faster if you have to get away if you're wearing pants, right? Wearing pants today, wore dresses yesterday. So I think, you know, it could have been for convenience. And I think it's also, again, it's a statement. You know, she put on her father's suit at one point. She appears in photographs by Emmy Lou Packard wearing pants, so. Someone else? Everybody's eager to go to lunch, yes. A
couple of questions. Did she ever wear them in public, the Tijuana? Do you know the origin of the Tijuana dress?
Yes, that's what, to save some time, I tried to avoid going into a long discussion of the Christian baptismal costumes that are adopted by indigenous women and modified with local dress styles, particularly 19th century dress styles. And yes, she did wear these in public, although I mostly where we see her performing is in the home. Mm-hmm. You know, most of the photographs, I mean, she did wear things in public, but the Tijuana costume, she probably never wore this.
The huipil grande.
The huipil grande. Yeah.
Which isn't even indigenous, right. It's lace. Yeah. That lace is not indigenous to Mexico. Right, so one theory is that it was in a trunk and washed up on the shore somewhere in the Pacific.
Exactly. The most important dresses were made in Belgium, mm-hmm. with Belgium fabrics. Mm-hmm. And also, I want to add a little about the China Poblana. The think of the China Poblana is that when Anna Sokolov was going to Mexico because
Anna Pavlova
mm-hmm. went to visit Fito Vesmalcar that actually was living in New York. Mm-hmm. And Anna Pavlova asked to Fito that she needs something Mexican. And Fito was the first person with Miguel Covarrubias to develop a choreographic mm-hmm. China Poblana dress. And it was the first time that was presented in public as an aesthetic.
Yeah.
And what happened is that then Miguel Covarrubias married Rose Rowland, and that's how she got also dressed as China Poblana, because Rose says, I want to be as famous, because Rose was a dancer. Mm-hmm. And she says, I want to be as famous as Anna Pavlova. And that's why they get also a dress designed by Fito Vesmalcar. So it's actually something theatrical, as he said. It was not a worried thing.
And the context that Juan is referring to is, I believe you're talking about the Noche Mexicana in 1921. So in 1921, in the post-revolutionary period, the Mexican government orchestrated the second centennial of Mexico's independence from Spain. They were celebrating the realization, the consummation of independence, and they organized a much more a popular kind of celebration that included in a very important exhibition of Mexican folk art and this performance in Chapultepec called the Noche Mexicana. And this was a counter response to the Porfirian Centennial that had been celebrated in 1910, where relatively little amount of attention was paid to Mexican art, and instead there was an exhibition of contemporary Spanish painting and an exhibition of Japanese decorative arts. And so during the administration of Álvaro Obregón, they said, well, we have to restage the centennial. And it was also at that event where Mexico's India Bonita was elected to represent the nation as the prettiest Indian girl. So it's very much theatrical, and I appreciate that James has called that out, that it's theatricality, it's performance. A different question about gardens or flowers or something else? This will be the last question. I'll take two more. One over here, and then one over here, and that'll be it.
I'm a little embarrassed. I don't know exactly how this is, but I ran upstairs and looked at the painting.
Mm-hmm.
And there's indications in the notes that you know, this is a sexual organ, and this mm-hmm. is a sexual organ. Are there notes from Frida Kahlo herself saying, I set out before I painted this to make this look like a man and a woman, this flower, this leaf, or this fruit look like a female organ, or is that just now other people's interpretations?
We've actually tried to be quite conservative in that, because there are some interpretations that try to identify everything in a way that is sexual or emblematic. I don't doubt that there are times where the works are emblematic, and sometimes I think they're just a celebration of texture and color, right? So we wanted to acknowledge those interpretations as potentially valid, and she didn't leave notes of that kind. So.
But she did, and Adriana knows this very well, in her diaries, mm-hmm. she has many diaristic drawings mm-hmm. that are incredibly sexualized, where the landscape is a breast sprouting milk, and
right.
where a rent in the landscape, like at the Pedregal, is clearly meant to be read as female genitalia. Mm-hmm. And this is, it's no stretch of the imagination. Plus, she's also very interested in pre-Columbian cosmology, where
right.
these kinds of procreative dualities often embodied in almost always singular figures, very important in terms of thinking about the cyclical nature of life and these figures, and she's always also engaging with those ideas, in part because of her nationalism, but also in part as a kind of response to a kind of Occidental conception of sexuality as wanton and demonized, in both as a sort of political statement, not an organized feminist ideology, but a political statement and a kind of anti-colonial stance. Mm-hmm.
And also in Mexican modern art, it's a canon. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of artists, for example, González Serrano, Diego Rivera, they explicitly work with flowers and food as sexual mm-hmm. matters. It's a canon. You can see it in 30, 40 artists mm-hmm. as a canon. Actually, they can build an exhibition on that,
yep.
on sexual organs through plants.
But I think this is an important point, because one thing that I always stress and that my colleagues all stress is that Kahlo has to be contextualized. Otherwise, it's not to say that she wasn't a genius and brilliant, but so were many other artists, and they were in dialogue with one another. So this is really what we're wanting to bring forward, is the conceptual richness, and it doesn't happen in a vacuum. So I'll take the last question over here. Absolutely.
And I just wondered whether the things that are in the collections that she collected, do we see many direct references in the artwork, in the paintings, in the diaries?
Can you repeat the question?
She's asking whether the things that Frida Kahlo collected, whether we see direct references in her paintings to the objects that she collected. Well, yes, but not always. So, for example, in the self-portrait with thorn necklace with hummingbird, that cat is based on a photograph. In one of the still lifes, did she have a cat?
Yeah.
Okay, she had a cat. So, but it's clearly taken from the photograph. In the one of the still lives that you'll see upstairs, there's an Ishoroishkwintli dog. It's a ceramic piece that belonged to Diego Rivera. So she does make references, but not always. So that was one thing that I was always noting is, you know, when I found the photograph of the cat, it's published in Frida Kahlo, her photos. I thought, well, that's the cat in self-portrait with thorn necklace with hummingbird. So there is an internal reference. There is a, again, thinking about her home as an extension of her creativity, a point that Juan also made, is really crucial. It's about contexts and multiple contexts. And I think that will bring us to a much richer understanding of Frida Kahlo's artistic contribution to Mexico and to art history. So thank you very much for your attention. And I know Gail Schmidt has some announcements for those of you who have lingered.
Thank you so much to our distinguished panel and to all of our guests who came today to support the exhibition and the garden throughout the year.